say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most
merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his only Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all of your sins. As a called and ordained servant of the word and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We chant the gratitude together. Old but there was no water for the people to drink. Therefore the people quarreled with Moses and said, "Give us water to drink." And Moses said to them, "Why do you quarrel with me? Why do you test the Lord?" But the people thirsted there for water, and the people grumbled against Moses and said, "Why did you bring us up out of Egypt to kill us and our children and our livestock with thirst?" So Moses cried to the Lord, "What shall I do with this people? They are almost ready to stone me." And the Lord said to Moses, "Pass on before the people, taking with you some of the elders of Israel, and take in your hand the staff with which you struck the Nile, and go. And behold, I will stand before you there on the rock at Horeb, and you shall strike the rock, and water shall come out of it, and the people will drink." And Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. And he called the name of the place Massa and Meribah, because of the quarreling of the people of Israel, and because they tested the Lord by saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?" This is the word of the Lord. We chant the graduate together. Printed. This is the word of the Lord. We rise and sing the Lenten verse on the top of page 157. Jacob, he gave us the well and drank from it himself, as commanded his sons and his livestock. Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. Whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty forever. The water that I will give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I may not be thirsty or have to come to draw water." Jesus said to her, "Go, call your husband and come here." The woman answered him, "I have no husband." Jesus said to her, "You are right in saying, 'I have no husband,' for you have had five husbands, and the one you now have is not your husband. What you have said is true." The woman said to him, "Sir, I perceive that you are a prophet. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, but you say that in Jerusalem is the place where people ought to worship." Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming and is now here, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for the Father is seeking such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth." The woman said to him, "I know that Messiah is coming, he who is called Christ. When he comes, he will tell us all things." Jesus said to her, "I who speak to you am he." Just then his disciples came back. They marveled that he was talking with a woman, but no one said, "What do you seek?" or "Why are you talking with her?" So the woman left her water jar and looked away to town and said to the people, "Come, see a man who told me all that I ever did. Can this be the Christ?" They went out of the town and were coming to him. Many Samaritans from that town believed in him because of the woman's testimony. "He told me all that I ever did." So when the Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay with them, and he stayed there 2 days. And many more believed because of his word. He said to the woman, "It is no longer because of what you said that we believe, for we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this is indeed the Savior, the Word." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Thank you.
In this lesson, Paul reminds us that suffering ultimately produces hope and strengthens us in faith in Jesus. And these two lessons tie together in our gospel, in which we see the woman at the well, having had a difficult life, being quenched with the living water of faith in Jesus. Our account begins with a bit of confrontation. For you see, the two characters in our lesson are of different cultural backgrounds, although they truly were cousins. A Samaritan was a person who was born half Jewish and half something else. This Samaritan culture was from what was deemed forbidden intermarriages of some of the Jewish people with the natives from the surrounding area. So the Jews did not like the Samaritans because they were not pure Jews. And the Samaritans did not like the Jews because they did not like them. And so there was this conflict, this struggle between Jews and Samaritans. Their conflict was so great that if there was only two of them, a Jew and a Gentile, in the same place, at the same time, they wouldn't even talk to each other. The Jews despised the Samaritans, and the Samaritans despised the Jews. Our account is about a man named Jesus. He is truly human, and we can see that he is human in the fact that in his human state, we are told that he is tired. Indeed, he has been on the road, walking with his disciples everywhere they went, and now he is tired. Kind of reminds me of that old saying, you know, any place is walking distance if you have the time. Well, they walked everywhere they went, and now we're told Jesus is tired, and so he stops and rests by the well. By the way, perhaps you didn't know, maybe I didn't tell you, but Jesus is Jewish, actually. He's not a Samaritan. He's not Hispanic. He's not Oriental. He's not Asian. He's not Anglo. He's Jewish. And remember, Jews did not normally speak with Samaritans, even if they were the only two people present. Yet, Jesus does speak to the Samaritan woman who he meets at the well where he stopped to rest. Her response when Jesus speaks to her is that she reminds him that they don't speak to each other. Now, I'm sure you're wondering a bit about this woman, but I'm not going to tell you too much about her just yet. That would ruin the lesson. Anyway, our lesson begins with this confrontation between Jesus the Jew and the woman the Samaritan. What happens is that Jesus asked her for a drink. But I guess I should tell you that what Jesus had in mind was not simply physical water, a physical drink. Jesus' intent was actually to bring the woman to know him as her Savior. It's just that water happened to be a good place to begin the conversation. Jesus asked for a drink of water, and her response was something like, "Are you talking to me?" And Jesus' answer is, "If you knew what I could give you, then you would ask me for a drink." But again, remember, Jesus is not speaking of physical water, but he is speaking of spiritual water, and the woman is thinking of physical water. The woman does not understand the distinction. She's like many of us who gather in church on Sunday morning. She has come to have her physical needs met, and Jesus is looking to fulfill her spiritual need. But the woman's thought is, if this guy can give me water, even though he doesn't have anything with which to draw water from the well, which is deep, then he must be greater than Jacob, our great-great-great-great-grandfather, who dug the well. So her response, and I would suggest her doubting response, might be something like, "Sir, I'd really like to see you give me the water." But not yet. Jesus is not quite ready to give her what she wants, because she still does not understand what she really needs. She's very much like many of us today. We know what we want, or at least we think we know what we want, and we think that what we want is what we need. We think we need this, that, or the other thing, but what we really need What we truly need is Jesus' absolution. We need to hear those most beautiful words, the words we hear at the beginning of every divine service. Your sins are forgiven. Because Jesus gave his life for you on the cross, because Jesus paid the eternal death penalty of hell for you on the cross, your sins are all forgiven. Those are the most precious, the most beautiful words we can hear, because with forgiveness of sins, the doors to heaven are opened wide and we have eternal salvation. Now the rest of the conversation between Jesus and the woman turns to a conversation on worship. Now the woman was not necessarily changing the subject, rather she was wanting to know how she might continue to confess and be given absolution of the Lord's forgiveness. Jesus' response is to worship in spirit and truth. We might translate that best for ourselves by saying we worship best when we say back to God the very word that he has given us to say. Worship is not worship because of where we do it. Worship is not so much the externals, not the ritual, not the traditions, although those are very helpful in facilitating our worship. Rather, worship that is true worship is worship that comes from the heart. Again, we worship best when we say back to God the very word that he has given us to say. Personally, I might struggle and fumble with what to say to God. When I open my Bible, I have God's word which he gives to me, a word which he gives to me to speak to him. Indeed, how much better can I speak to my Lord than to speak the very words that are his word? If you've been following along in the divine service this morning, you will notice that most of what we have been speaking to our Lord this morning has been his word, which we are speaking back to him, and that is what our liturgy is all about. Speaking back to God the very words that he has given us to say. And it is our liturgy which flows out of what God has given us and which ties us to those who have gone before us and those who will go after us, transcending time, not simply contemporary, here today and gone tomorrow. But let's get back and finish our lesson. The lesson concludes with a bit of revelation. The woman, the Samaritan, who had come out truly at an odd time of the day, so as not to be seen by others, this woman, having met Jesus by his design and plan, now confesses that she believes in the coming Messiah. Jesus then confesses to her that he is that Messiah, and indeed she confesses that she believes that he is the Messiah as well, and now she must go off and tell others. The others come and hear, and they say they believe because of what the woman said, and finally the others say they no longer believe simply because of the word of the woman, but because they themselves have seen and heard the word. Here we are reminded again and again of the importance of the word. It is through the means of grace, the word in particular, that faith is given, along with the other gifts God has to give, forgiveness, life, and salvation. As we read and study our text for today, we come to a bit of restoration. That is, we come to restore our broken relationship with our Lord. Often I hear things like, well, I don't go to church because there's hypocrites in church. And I suppose that's true. Indeed, we profess to be Christians, and yet we fail day in and day out. And we too sin day in and day out. But that's the very reason we come to church, to confess our sins, to hear God's word of forgiveness, and to have him help us to live better godly lives. Indeed, a response to that statement is, because someone else is pretending and not being a good Christian, are we going to forfeit our own soul as well? Indeed, we come to church, the divine service, in spirit and truth. We come to be given the gifts the Lord has to give. And as we are given those gifts, we are filled. We are filled with faith, forgiveness, life, and salvation. We are filled with joy, peace. We are filled with the Lord. We are robed with his robes of righteousness. Ultimately, as we are given the gifts our Lord has to give, we are filled to the point that we illustration before, and it's quite fitting. We are like a cup, and God is like a pitcher. Every time we make use of the means of grace, hearing the word of God, remembering our baptism, coming to the Lord's Supper, He fills us, and He fills us until we overflow, and we can't help ourselves, but we share our faith with others. Indeed, that is very important in our Christian faith and life, getting to the point of sharing our faith with others so they too might be a part of God's kingdom. Of course, the difficulty is, as we tend to grow and mature in our faith, our glasses tend to get bigger and bigger, so that it takes more to be filled before we overflow. And that's unfortunate. Perhaps that's why God tells us to be as little children, to have small cups, so that we might overflow rather quickly. Yes, we worship Jesus best when we worship Him in spirit and truth, recognizing and confessing our sins and being given from Him forgiveness, newness of life, strengthening of faith, and salvation. And as we are given from the Lord, so we pass that on to others. Today we continue to give thanks for opportunities that we have. Today to hear God's word, to be strengthened and filled so that we may take God's gifts out with us and share them with others through our actions as well as through our words and thoughts. Indeed, we praise the Lord. We pray that He will continue to bless us with the word that is spoken here, and we say to Him be the glory, for Jesus' sake. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep the hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus to life everlasting. Amen. Having heard the word of the Lord, we respond to that word by confessing our faith. This morning we do so with the words of the Apostles' Creed as printed on page 159. Please rise. We confess our faith together.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The very day He rose again from the dead, He ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence He will come to judge the living.
Giver of all things, we rejoice today in the goodness of your creation, in your mercies new every morning, and in the gift of a Savior from whom we have been delivered from sin and death. We give you thanks that for your Holy Spirit, for the gift of faith, for the promise of everlasting life, and for the privilege of prayer. For the church purchased with the blood of Christ, for all pastors who build with your Spirit, proclaim your saving gospel, and serve us with your holy sacraments, for our perfection in love and for the good works that manifest this love for our neighbor and for our witness, that we may speak your word to those who do not yet know you. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the baptized in their vocation of worship, witness, prayer, and works of mercy, for strength in the midst of temptation, for courage in the face of threat, for hope in the times of despair, and for confidence amid doubts and fears, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Missionaries far and near, for the Lord's blessing upon mission congregations, for younger congregations, for our steadfastness in the word, for the furnishing of the work of the kingdom everywhere, for the renewal of existing congregations, and for the Lord to prosper the work of the church in every place, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the Lord to preserve our nation and prosper the cause of justice in this land, we pray for Donald, our president, Congress of these United States, Ray, our governor, and for all elected and appointed civil servants. Grant us peace among the nations and watch over those who protect us in the armed forces of our land. Lord, let us for the dying near the end of their earthly lives, for those who struggle with adversity and sorrow, especially for Mary, Marion, Verna, Gloria, Carol, Debbie, Linda, Maddie, Marie, Jim, Olivia, Arthur, William, Scott, Vic, Riley, Leon, Margie, Carol, Krista, Paul, Kathy, Joanne, Lorraine, Miranda, Betty, George, Josephina, Maria, Mary, Lauren, Odette, Sharon, Dan, Eileen, Matthew, Charlie, David, Marion, Janet, Karen, and for all those we now name in our hearts before you. Let us pray to the Lord. For those who grieve the loss of loved ones, for our own endurance and faith through trials, for the Lord to make us ready to receive our Savior when he comes in glory as King and Judge of all, for the families of the martyrs and those persecuted for the faith, for the Lord to keep us in fellowship with those who have fallen asleep in the Lord and now rest from their labors. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the unity of church and doctrine and life, for our communion this day upon the body and blood of Christ, for the Lord to strengthen our faith and love for one another, for the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving that we sing, and for the Lord to accept the tithes and offerings we bring in response to his goodness to us, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
All these things and everything else we need, let us pray to the Lord in the name of Jesus Christ, his Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with the Father and the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated. At this time, we gather our first fruits, tithes, and offerings as the offering baskets are being passed around. You should have a record of us with there to you. Please tell me to pass it on. If you're a first-time guest, we especially ask for your address that we may acknowledge your attendance with us this morning. We are celebrating the Lord's Supper this morning because of our care and concern for your spiritual well-being. We do practice the loving practice of close communion. If you're a first-time guest, we'd ask that you read our statement of our practice on the Lord's Supper found on the card in the pew in front of you, and certainly if you have any questions, you can speak with me before approaching the table. Again, as I said at the beginning of the service, following the giving of the offering and before preparing the table, I will go and wash after the elders have brought the offerings up. They will wash as well so that we will be as clean as possible when you come to the table. This morning in particular, I would ask that you would put your hand out, preferably your right hand over your left hand, that I might put the wafer in your palm. You can decide whether you want the common cup or the individual cup. Again, understanding scientifically speaking, the common cup, silver, a noble metal, silver, gold, and wine, they have done studies, is negligible in the passing of germs, but if you'd rather the individual cup, partake of the individual cup. We receive our offerings.
Thank you.
salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who overcame the assaults of the devil and gave his life as a ransom for many, that with cleansed hearts we might be prepared joyfully to celebrate the Paschal feast in sincerity and truth. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, Son, into our flesh to bear our sin and be our Savior. With repentant joy, we receive the salvation accomplished for us by the all-availing sacrifice of his body and his blood on the cross. Gathered in the name and the remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood as he bids us do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth, to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb and his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers, deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our
Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." The same way also after the supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to the disciples, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. continue on page 165 with the Nunc Dimittis. Please rise. Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift, and we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same in faith towards you and in fervent love for one another. Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Standing, respectfully greet each other.